Good morning. I'd like to welcome our Bethel Church family and friends to our online service today. I would like to greet you with words from Psalm 62, verses 1 and 2, and then verses 5 to 8. Psalm 62, verses 1 and 2, and then verses 5 to 8. It says, "Truly, my soul finds rest in God. My salvation comes from Him. Truly, He is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will never be shaken." And then verse 5 to 8. "Yes, my soul find rest in God. My hope comes from Him. Truly, He is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in Him at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts to Him, for God is our refuge." And we can echo verse 8, to trust in the Lord at all times and to pour out our hearts to Him, for He is our refuge, our place of safety today. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank You for the opportunity to present ourselves to You. And as we have gathered to worship, we ask that You would give us great joy in remembering how You have been faithful to care for us, how You have been grateful, we are grateful that You have provided salvation for us, that You are our rock, You are that figure of strength and resilience in the midst of difficult times. We pray that we could find rest for our souls, rest in You, and that You would help us to trust You in all times and to pour out our hearts to You. And we thank You for this opportunity to be gathered for time in the Word, time in song, time in prayer, and You would give us strength because we have been here with You today. In Jesus' name, amen. I would like to highlight a few pieces of information for our awareness today. As you already know, our building is available and open on Monday to Friday, generally from 9 till 4 p.m. You are free to come and make use of the library or to drop off donations at the church office or any other inquiries or requests that you may have. Please call ahead to confirm just in case there's been a change in our immediate schedule, but the plan is that we are open from 9 till 4 each day, Monday to Friday. Donations can be made online through Access Credit Union or by dropping them off here at the church or by mail. We thank you for your faithful giving and support for the work that continues from Bethel. If you know of someone who does not have the ability to view our services and who would like an audio version, please notify the church office. We can burn a CD for them to listen to and benefit from, and we will gladly deliver it to their home. There are a couple other events to know about. One, we will be rescheduling the baptismal service, which we had hoped to have in early June. The discipleship class is encouraged to keep working on your studies as per the schedule in your workbook. I will be in touch with the discipleship class members by phone. We thank you for your faithful attention to the studies you've been doing. There is also a plan for a men's fishing weekend in June. An email has been sent to all who had indicated an interest. And if you have questions, please contact Chad at 384-9109 or Jason at 362-7816. This information and more is available in your bulletin, which can be found through resources at our website.
By grace alone, somehow I stand, where even angels fear to tread. Invited by redeeming love, before the throne of God above, He pulls me close with nail-scarred hands into his everlasting arms. When condemnation grips my heart and Satan tempts me to despair, I hear the voice that scatters fear. Oh, the great I am, the Lord is here. Oh, praise the one who fights for me and shields my soul eternally. Of majesty.
apart exceeds all praise. The sunlight fills the skies, your goodness fills my life. For all your precious gifts, receive my gratefulness.
Now we'd like to take time for prayer together. And as we do that, I'd like to remind you that our missionaries for the month are Amanda and Amelia Weeb, serving in Mexico, and they have some reports for us. They report that regarding health, a praise item, the pandemic has not really affected their specific area, and the children and their families, as well as the teachers, are doing well health-wise. Secondly, a prayer request that for those children who are spending more time at their homes, but do not always feel safe and secure at home. And so we want to pray for those families that they could that the children could be safe and protected. We also want to share a few notes, a note of praise, first of all, that Jennifer Lowen was encouraged by recent test results regarding her health. We also want to acknowledge a continuing recovery for Dawn Enns, who had recent medical issues and is recovering at home. We want to pray for Frank and Mary Enns as they continue with Frank's cancer care. We want to pray for Grace Muindi, the wife of Elijah in Kenya, who has important health needs at this time. Pray for those who are grieving and mourning the recent loss of loved ones. There may be others that you know. There are certainly some from our church family and others you know who are working through those matters of separation and grief from the loss of loved ones. We want to pray for our governments, both here provincially and for our friends in North Dakota and for our country of Canada and for the United States and other nations represented by our church family. We want to pray for those places, for wisdom for the governments as they care for their people, and that we would be mindful of the responsibilities they bear and encourage them in it and pray for them as well. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to present ourselves to you in prayer today. We are reminded that you are aware of what is going on in every part of our world. There are no surprises to you. And as we continue before you, we ask that you would be with Amanda Weeb and Amelia Weeb in Mexico. We thank you for the praise item that there seems to be generally good health in the region where they are living. And the families and teachers are, the children and their families as well as the teachers are generally doing well in health matters. But there was a prayer request expressed as well for those spending more time at home. In some cases, the children do not feel safe and secure, and we pray that you would protect them there and give wisdom to other counselors or friends who may be around them. We would pray for our families here at home as they deal with the ongoing realities of no school and possibly no work in some cases, and all the tensions and the hurts and the needs and the challenges that that brings to each home. We ask for courage, strength, wisdom, patience, provision, and ask that you would just give us that sensitivity to how to love and care for others around us who have needs. We want to give thanks with Jennifer Lowen and Dan and the family regarding the fact that Jennifer's recent test results were positive and encouraging regarding her present health. And we just ask that you would give her peace and calm and her physical body strength as she continues to recover from the care she's been receiving. We pray for Dawn Enns, who is continuing to recover at home. And thank you for the quick intervention that he received for his care. We pray for Frank and Mary Ann as they continue to walk through the journey of cancer and the care that Frank is receiving. Thank you for the strength he has received for enjoying doing the things that are special to him. And we just pray you give them courage for each day in their home. We want to pray for Grace Muindi in Kenya and for her current medical needs, and for her and Elijah as they are involved in the information, and for the doctors as they continue to provide insight and care for Grace, and for your protection for their family and home at this time. We want to pray for those who are grieving and mourning the recent loss of loved ones, and we are mindful that we have friends here in the church family who have lost loved ones. There are others besides. And we pray that we could be aware of and sensitive to the needs of our friends and family who have lost loved ones. We want to pray for our governments. You've taught us to pray for those who have authority over us. And we want to pray that they would guide our province and guide the state of North Dakota, where we have church family as well, and guide the country of Canada and the United States with wisdom, with sensitivity to the genuine needs, with a deep concern for knowing the facts and for acting in ways that are thoughtful and give opportunity and hope to the people of each place, whether in Manitoba or North Dakota, in Canada or the United States. We thank you for the opportunity to present ourselves to you, remembering, as we read already, that you are a refuge in our time of need. So we ask that you would watch over us. We thank you for the way you have provided and continue to provide for us as a church family. And we pray that we would continue to find strength in you and that we would learn new and creative ways to walk together. In Jesus' name, amen.
look a bit fed up. What's the matter?
Oh, I'm in big trouble.
Oh, dear. What have you done?
Well, it's not so much what I've done. It's more, what I didn't do.
So, what did you didn't do?
I didn't make my mom a Mother's Day card.
Why not? Did you forget?
No, I remember it all right. But, you see, I'm a boy of principles. I said, if there's no Kids' Day, then there shouldn't be a Mother's Day or a Father's Day.
Oh, I bet that didn't go over very well.
No, my dad explained that Mother's Day was a nice way of thinking about our moms and of all the things that they do for us. Well, I said to Dad, but Mom is just a housewife and only works part of the time and really part-time at the office. So what does she really do for us?
You didn't say that loud enough for your mom to hear, did you?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's not very smart.
Yeah, that wasn't the right thing to say. Mom said she needed to go for a walk.
Yeah, well, I don't blame her.
I told Dad that Mom's always getting me to make my bed, to clean my room, and do other jobs too.
Well, yeah, that sounds like a good idea. You know, I have to do that too.
But I slave away at school all day, and I'm tired when I get home. But Mom, she only goes to the office for a few hours a week.
And I suppose you think she spends the rest of the day just with her feet up, drinking coffee?
Yeah, exactly. That's my point.
In our house, we all have to help with the chores. And sometimes, Mom even gives us some money to buy a treat. Do you think that's fair?
Maybe. Anyway, do you want to know what happened next?
Yes. What?
Well, for some strange reason, my mom decided to go on strike. She said she was going to take a break from the work that she does. And Dad even suggested that Mom go out and she goes out for the whole day and even gave some money to go and treat herself. And then he gave me this great big long list of jobs to do.
Whew, that's a long list.
Yeah, it says I need to do the things that Mom does, like wash the dishes, vacuum the rugs, dust and polish, make part of the supper by peeling and boiling potatoes, make a cake, I have no idea how to make a cake, go shopping, drop off a card at Grandma's, read a story to my younger sister. Whew, I went shopping, and my arms are still aching from going shopping. I didn't know how heavy those bags could get.
It says here make lunch. So what did you make?
What did I make? I made a huge mess. That's what I made. I thought I'd make wieners and beans.
Yum, that's my favorite. Sounds simple. So what happened?
How was I supposed to know that beans, they can explode in the microwave if you have them in there for over 15 minutes? I guess I never put a lid on the dish.
Well, you know, I actually came over just to see if you could join me to go for a bike ride.
Dad said I can't go out and play until I've done at least half of the things on the list. I'm not even close to that yet.
Yeah, moms do a ton of work every day.
I never realized how busy her life was. I am now starting to see that she does so many things that I just took for granted.
Yeah, you bet. And if she's like my mom, she does it without complaining. Well, most of the time. I sure am thankful for all the things that my mom does for me.
Yeah, me too. You know, I better go and see if maybe I can still make that card and write out a bunch of things that I'm thankful for, just to let her know. And I think I gotta start to do some more things to help her out around the house too.
Probably starting with cleaning out the microwave, I guess, eh?
Yeah. Thanks for reminding me. Well, maybe we could have a bike ride later, if I have the time or the energy left for it. I gotta go. See ya.
Well, kids, in Ephesians 6:2, it says, honor your father and mother. Kids, if you haven't done so yet, let your mom know how thankful you are for all the things that she does for you. And make sure that you always try to help her out, too. Now, here's a bunch of videos and pictures from people in the Bethel Church who want to say thanks to their moms. Let's watch.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom!
I love you, Mom. You give nice hugs. Happy Mother's Day.
Thank you for teaching us school. I love you, Mom. Happy Mother's Day.
I am thankful for Mom giving us, Mom protect us and give us healthy food sometimes.
I am thankful for Mommy because God made her, and I'm thankful for that she makes good food sometimes sweet.
I'm thankful for Mom that puts me to bed and makes good food.
Thank you, Mom,
for all the things you do for us.
Thanks, Mom, for always taking the effort and time to come watch all of our sports games. Love you.
Thanks for loving me so much and even pretending to love our pets. Love you.
Thanks, Mom, for being the most loving and caring taxi driver there is. Love you.
Thanks, Mom, for being the best homeschool teacher I could ever have. I think I'm gonna stay home from now on. Love you. Happy Mother's Day.
Mom, thank you for all those years of dragging us around the countryside and pretending to enjoy watching us play sports. Thank you for going camping with us, taking us camping, even though we found out later that you really didn't like it at all. But seriously, thank you for being such a positive role model and for showing us what it's like to be a godly person.
Mom, thanks for not selling my motorcycle after picking you up from work and doing a wheelie. I appreciate that a lot. And Mom, thanks for teaching me how to be content with what I have. Mom, I love you.
Thanks, Mom, for not telling me how Sparky the dog really died until I was mature enough to handle it. Thanks, Mom, for loving our kids, our wives, and our dad, and being such a positive role model to everybody around you. We love you. Happy Mother's Day.
Mom, thank you for praying for us for all those years, for extra guardian angels, for protection. It obviously worked because the four of us are still here. Love you. Mom, again, happy Mother's Day. Love you very much.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom.
Hey, Mom.
Thank you so much for encouraging us and teaching us.
Thanks for all that you do, and thank you for loving us.
We love you, Mom.
Thanks, Mom, for helping me paint my room.
Thank you, Mom and Nana, for all your love and support.
Thank you, Mom, for helping me with my schoolwork.
Thank you, Mom, for baking yummy cakes.
I love my mom because she encourages me to be a better person.
I love my mom because she goes out of her way to do things to make me happy.
I love you, Mom. I don't know what I'd do without you.
I love you, Mom. You mean so much to me.
I love you to the moon and back, Mom.
Happy Mother's Day.
Thanks, Mom, for taking care of us.
Thank you for making our food.
Thank you for having Mother's Day, Mom.
Our scripture reading today is from John chapter 5, verses 1 to 13. John chapter 5, verses 1 to 13, and I will be reading it from the New International Version. Sometime later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for one of the Jewish festivals. Now there is in Jerusalem near the Sheep Gate a pool, which in Aramaic is called Bethesda, and which is surrounded by five covered colonnades. Here a great number of disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, the paralyzed. One who was there had been an invalid for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked him, "Sir, do you want to get well?" "Sir," the invalid replied, "I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. While I am trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me." Then Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your mat, and walk." At once the man was cured. He picked up his mat and he walked. The day on which this took place was a Sabbath. And so the Jewish leaders said to the man who had been healed, "It is the Sabbath. The law forbids you to carry your mat." But he replied, "The man who made me well said to me, 'Pick up your mat and walk.'" So they asked him, "Who is this fellow who told you to pick it up and walk?" The man who was healed had no idea who it was, for Jesus had slipped away into the crowd that was there. I read just that far from God's word this morning. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, as we take time to study this passage and to learn from it for our own life and practice today, I pray that you would give special liberty and insight and wisdom to Pastor Mark to lead us and instruct us and encourage us. We thank you for the opportunity to be students of the Word and learning together and practicing it where we live. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, happy Mother's Day to all of you, to all of you mothers, and I guess it should almost be more so Women's Day. So happy Mother's Day, happy Women's Day to all of you out there, and so today's sermon is not going to be geared just towards mothers, although I might have one or two stories that might mention a mother in it. Hopefully, this is something for all of us and a challenge as well. So it's not going to be maybe a classic kind of Mother's Day type of sermon here. So I'll start off with a question, and the question is, have you ever tried to escape punishment or a consequence by not taking responsibility for something that you did? So have you ever tried to escape punishment or a consequence by not taking responsibility for something you did? I would venture a guess that most of us have done that. We've come up with an excuse, or we've tried to dodge some kind of consequence for responsibility. Now, you might have all kinds of stories about times in which you have actually done that, or maybe other people have kind of mentioned to you, and you've heard other stories of that as well. And what I found interesting is when I went on the internet, I actually found these things called excuse generators. And we'll put up on the screen for you right now one that a gentleman has in his office, and these are Dave's excuse generators. And as you can see by the picture, you simply just pick one thing of each category and you come up with an excuse for Dave being late. Now, I know it's just kind of a comical thing to put out there, but unfortunately, I think all too often we look for excuses to dodge responsibility or to point responsibility or direct it somewhere else. Maybe you had a mother tell you that sometime, you know, make sure you take responsibility for your actions. Now, I shared a story, I think, a few weeks ago and about myself going to an awards day as a child growing up. And so I was in grade 4, and my mom said to me, "Do you want to go to the awards night thing at school?" I didn't really want to go, and finally I said, "Well, I'll go, but only if I can go dressed as I am right now." And at that time, I was outside and living on the farm, and I loved being outside. I spent a lot of my summers being barefoot and quite often just being bareback. So I think I had like a pair of shorts on, and I think I was barefoot. I don't even know if I had a shirt on or not. I think I was bareback, and she allowed me to go. And so we get to the school, and lo and behold, I end up winning an award, which she didn't know, nor did I. and I had to go up on stage like that. Well, I share that story because my mom was and still is a wonderful encourager for me, and she's one who always stressed the fact of, you know what, you can be an independent, you know, person. But she always made it clear that whatever my decisions were, I'm going to have to face the consequences. So that day, I had to face the consequences of going up accepting this award from a teacher and kind of feeling, to be honest, pretty embarrassed about the fact of, well, you know, maybe I'm not really dressed for the occasion. So that's maybe why I'm dressing up a little bit more today. Who knows? But, you know, today, the focus of our sermon today is twofold. First, I want to remind you of just some of the promises that God has for us and some of the things that God has done for us. And then, secondly, for us to be encouraged to take responsibility for actions and decisions that we make. All right, so one of the commercials that we see on TV just recently, it makes a statement, and it's talking about this COVID-19, and it makes a statement really solemn about, right now it's hard to see positives or be thankful for things in Manitoba. And I listen to that ad, and it frustrates me every time I hear it because I'm like, you're wrong. There are so many things to still be thankful for. God has blessed us in incredible ways. Today, we may pay more attention to our mothers and to be thankful for our mothers, grandmothers, wives, and so on, and that's all good, and that's a wonderful thing to be thankful for. But other things that we can be thankful for, and I just jotted some down here really quickly, sunshine, freedom, good health, laughter, love that we can share with a spouse or a family member, God's word, blessings of a job, church family, a home, the beauty of nature, celebrating spring and the seasons, and the list can go on and on. There are so many things to be thankful for. I decided just to quickly pop up a few verses up on the screen for you as to what the Bible says about some things we can be thankful for. Here's just a few. First off, God has provided instruction for us in the Bible. Psalm 119, verse 105 says, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." God has provided guidance and comfort through the Holy Spirit. Romans 15, verse 13 says, "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope." God has provided salvation through Jesus Christ's death and resurrection. Ephesians 2, verses 8 and 9 say, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast." God has also provided the hope of eternity with Him. John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish but have eternal life." And the last one I'm mentioning here is God is in control and encourages us to continue to live for Him. We can take comfort in the words that were spoken to Joshua. And although these were spoken to Joshua, I think that that it's a wonderful verse for us to be claiming as well, and that we can take comfort and encouragement in. From Joshua 1:9, it says, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened and do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." God is fully aware of all the details of your life. He's not surprised or thrown off track because of COVID-19 or anything else that may possibly come our way. And God has done all of the work needed for our salvation and for us to have a relationship with Him. He's done all that work. All right, so we can praise God for many things. Now I'd like us to shift our focus over to the passage that Pastor Randy already read for us from John chapter 5. And this passage demonstrates both God's power and also our responsibility. John chapter 5 tells the story of Jesus healing a man that was crippled. So if you have your Bibles along, please, you know, turn there and you can kind of read along. I'm not going to go through this verse by verse, but just a little bit of background. Jesus went to this pool that had people of all kinds of illnesses and physical disabilities that were gathered there. Verse 3 says, "Here a great number of disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, the paralyzed." Now, there's an interesting little aside here. If you have your Bibles open, or if it's an app on your phone, check to see if verse 4 is actually listed. Because in some versions, verse 4 will be listed right in the body of the manuscript, and in others, it will be a footnote. Now, the NIV doesn't include it, but or at least not in the not in the body, but it does include it in a footnote. King James Version includes it right in the body. And that verse says, quote, "For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first, after the troubling of the water, stepped in, was made whole of whatsoever disease he had," end quote. Now, is it right, is it wrong for it to be in there? You know what, the reality is that when I did some research on it, some of the versions looked at it and they said, well, for them, there weren't quite enough old manuscripts, early manuscripts that mentioned this to include it. Others said, yes, we feel like there is enough manuscripts, early manuscripts to include it. But either way, it's either listed as a footnote or it's listed right in the body. So we can take it to say that this is true and that this did happen. Now, back in those days, obviously, people believed a lot sort of in spirits more so than our culture does. But the reality is that so the Spirit of God would move, or an angel of the Lord would move and would trouble or stir up the water, and then the first person in would be healed. Now, we don't really have a whole lot of record of that happening and so on and so forth, but we need to believe that just as it, because it's stated as such. Now, some commentaries stated maybe this was only during a certain time. Maybe this was only at certain times of the year, and this was just before Passover. So did this commonly happen just before Passover? Did this happen on a regular basis? Did it rarely happen? You know what? We don't really know, and really that's not the point of this. Because the reality is that let's simply allow God to be God, and God could have stirred or moved those waters by an angel or whatever and brought healing to people that went into that water at that time, or at least the first person that went in. So God most certainly can decide to heal however he chooses, and he has the right to do that however he wants. Now, there was a man that was there that was an invalid for 38 years. And Jesus asks him, do you want to get well? Do you want to get well? I mean, at first you read that and you think, well, obviously he wants to get well. He's there, isn't he? But I think it's a valid question. Because we don't know the background to this individual. We know very little about him other than the fact that he's there. And so Jesus asks him, do you want to get well? Again, we may think, well, that's automatic. But we don't really know how comfortable was he in his life. Now, maybe his life was extremely difficult and he was pleading and begging to get well. Maybe, and Jesus just asks him, do you really want to get well? Meaning, or are you comfortable with the way things are at? And so he answers it, but he basically answers it by saying, sir, I have no one to help me get into the pool when it is stirred and so on. So essentially he's saying back, yes. Now let me take a little bit of a timeout. Timeout from the story, and I want to kind of shift this over to an application for you. Do you really want to get well? Now you may say, Mark, I'm not sick. All right. Do you really want to grow in your relationship with God? Or maybe you don't have a relationship with God as Lord and Savior. Do you really want to be living for him? Would you like Jesus Christ to come into your life? We may say, well, of course the answer should be yes to those things. And yet, unfortunately, I think at times Christians, like others, are guilty of saying, you know what, I'm okay with life just the way it is. Oh, people may come to church and they may worship God and so on, but do they truly want to grow in their faith? Well, maybe yes, but not if I have to put in more work or do some other things and so on. You see, some people, if they're asked that question straight up, do you want to grow in your faith? Do you want to have a personal relationship with God? Do you want to grow deeper? It's a valid question. And unfortunately, sometimes, and for some people, that answer may be, I'm not really sure if I do. So I ask you again, if you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, do you want one? If you are already a follower of Jesus Christ, do you want to grow in your faith? Now, the story continues, and it basically says, so right after this man talks about the fact of that he was trying to get into the pool, other people go in before him and so on, Jesus said to him, get up and walk. He says, get up, pick up your mat and walk. At once the man was cured. At once the man was cured. It doesn't go into details of what Jesus said. Did he come over? Did he touch him? We don't know. And again, I think the reason that we don't know is because it's not recorded for us, and therefore that's not really the point as to how Jesus healed him. The fact is, Jesus cured him. He healed him. He did all of the work. The man had no responsibility at all other than apparently to have a desire to be healed. And then Jesus tells him, get up, pick up your mat, and walk. What if the man would have asked for help? Well, I'm not sure if I can get up. I need some assistance to help me and so on. What if he would have said, before I try to get up, can you guarantee me that I'm healed? Can you, Jesus, write a certificate that says this is going to last for the rest of my lifetime? Actually, you know, Jesus, maybe I'm going to need some financial help too. Could you kind of help out with that area? But he doesn't do any of that, right? But Jesus tells him, get up, pick up your mat, and walk. Now, again, I'm going to take a little bit of an aside here. Mothers, and not just mothers, parents, and others as well. But let me just kind of point to mothers and to parents right now. Parents, and I'm guilty of this as well. Sometimes we want to help our children or others so much that we actually take away their responsibilities. You see, in this case, you know, others could have come alongside and said, oh, we always help him. Let me help this guy up. No, it's his responsibility. Get up, pick up your mat, and walk. That's up to you to do now. I think sometimes as parents and as others, we can mean well, but we actually help sometimes in enabling the other person not to take responsibility. Now, sometimes I've experienced, you know, situations where someone has asked for some ideas or some help, either, let's say, with a relationship or something along that line, and they say, you know what, here's this relationship and it's broken. It needs fixing. But the reality is that, you know, I as a pastor or as someone can come alongside, part of my role is to hopefully help to kind of point out some things that are helpful, but it's not up to me or anyone else for that matter to fix that relationship. It's up to the people involved in that relationship to fix it. It's their responsibility. And sometimes we care for our families and others so much that we get that warped and we start thinking that somehow it's our responsibility to fix other people's problems. It may be our responsibility to assist them or to point things out, but ultimately they need to take responsibility as well. And that is a hard lesson. And we don't always get that right, do we? At least I sure don't. But the reality is that we're supposed to stop looking for excuses. We're supposed to man up or woman up and take responsibility for those things. Now, getting back to this story, this man actually acted and he took responsibility for the things he could control. Now, the cure was out of his control. He couldn't cure himself. Jesus cured him. Jesus healed him. But then he needed to make a response. And that response was all up to him to obey. And he did. Get up, pick up your mat, and walk. Now, mothers, you have a huge, huge calling to be a mother. And at times you may feel like this is way too big of a job. I want to encourage you, with God's help, and that's key, and we'll touch on that later, with God's help, you have a responsibility to act in godly ways in which God has called you. If God has called you to be a mother, you know what? Then God has called you into a role that he will equip you for. It is a huge responsibility, yes, but with God's help, we can do it. Now, there are numerous stories or other stories in Scripture that talk about people who maybe did not take responsibility. For example, really quickly, after Adam and Eve sinned by eating of the forbidden fruit, what did Adam do? He blamed Eve. He said, "The woman you put here with me." So actually, he blames the woman, and he also blames God because he says, "Well, the woman you put here, right? Not my fault, you put her here." That's a dangerous path to go down. And then Eve shifts the excuse over to somebody else as well. And she blames the devil, saying like, and she ends up saying, oh, the serpent deceived me. Which might be true, but again, you know, it's her responsibility as to what she does with that. Another story was the story of the rich young ruler who comes to Jesus and he asks, what must I do to be saved? And Jesus gives him an answer. He says, I've done lots of those things and so on. And then he ends up saying in Mark chapter 10, verse 21, Jesus tells him to go and sell everything. And then he says, then come follow me. And what's this man's response? Scripture says, at this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. So it seems to imply that he doesn't necessarily come back to follow Jesus. You know, he had a responsibility. Go and do these things and then come follow me. And imagine that call. You know, in today's world, we look at that and we think, well, this was an invite to a relationship with Jesus Christ. Yes, it was. But maybe it was way more than that, right? I mean, this was actually Jesus physically standing there telling this guy, he says, then come follow me. Come on and join. Like, you know, as I journey around the countryside, come and follow me. What an incredible opportunity. But it's his responsibility. It's this man, the rich young ruler. It was his responsibility of what he was going to do with that. And he goes away sad because he's not willing to do the things that God asked him to do. One of the things that impresses me about those stories is that Jesus respected their decisions. He respected their decisions. If a person chooses not to follow him, he didn't change the rules of the game or diminish the calling just so that they would change their mind. He didn't say to Adam and Eve after they sinned, oh, guys, look, it's really okay. You know what? We'll wipe the slate clean again. You can try again. No. He told them clearly, they disobeyed, they had to take responsibility and face the consequences. He didn't offer to the lame man that was there by the pool, or at least we don't have record of it, he didn't offer him all kinds of other assistance to get up and all the rest of this. No, he simply said, get up, pick up your mat, and walk. He basically said, that's your responsibility. This rich young ruler, he didn't run after him. He didn't change his advice. He didn't run after him and says, oh, you know what, you'd be such good, a great follower of mine, so you know what, maybe you don't have to sell everything, maybe just a few things, okay, and then come back. No, Jesus didn't soft sell the message like that. He simply said, here it is, now it's your responsibility. And each one of those people had to pay the consequences of their decisions. And I jotted down a few stories here about some negative things that I did as a child or as a teenager, and I had to face the consequences, but instead of me going into those, I'll maybe save those for another sermon. But there's also positive consequences, aren't there? For example, when I made the choice to ask a beautiful young woman by the name of Irma to share life with me, I had to face the consequences. No, that sounds so bad, right? The reality is I was then incredibly blessed to have this incredible woman come into my life and to be, you know, mother of our children and to just, you know, to share life with and continue to share life with. So, yes, we have to face consequences for poor choices. We also get the blessing when we make good choices as well. Now, you are responsible for your relationship with God. No one else. You are responsible for your relationship with God. I realize that today is a day that's filled with emotion for a lot of people, not just for mothers. And a website by CRU, which was formerly known as Campus Crusade for Christ, it actually says, quote, a responsible life is not lived by feelings and circumstances. All right? A responsible life is not lived by feelings and circumstances. If we're going to live life responsibly, we're not going to be basing it just on common thought or how we feel right in that moment or the circumstances around us. It's got to be deeper than that. Now, you may feel blessed because of your relationship with your mother or your children or your spouse, and that's great. We want to celebrate that. Then you have the responsibility of how you're going to act because of that. Likewise, you also have a responsibility to do with those emotions that you may have that maybe aren't positive, those emotions that you have that maybe deal with anger or disappointment, frustration, or maybe even hatred towards somebody else. You have a responsibility for how you're going to respond in those circumstances as well. You may not control your circumstances, but you do control how you're going to respond to them. Now, I fully realize that for some of you at this point, your mind may be filled and your emotions might be really anxious. And you may say, but Mark, I just can't handle the stuff that's going on right now. And maybe that has to do with this whole COVID-19 and all of those changes, and you're really dealing with anxiety. Maybe it's a completely different issue. Maybe it's a relationship with your mom, or if you're a mother or parent, maybe it's with a child or someone else. Maybe it's a work thing, and you're like, great, now I just feel super guilty because I'm supposed to take this responsibility, and I'm trying, I really am, but I'm just failing in so many areas, and I just can't handle this. Look, I want to be clear. I am not trying to guilt you or to make you feel bad. My goal is actually to have us all come to God. Now, you may say, oh, but Mark, you just said, you know, some of these things might be my responsibility. And yes, that's true. But God has designed us to cry out for help to Him and to accept the fact that He is the one that wants to carry you. He's the one that wants to carry your emotions, your relationships, and all of who you are. God has not designed you to walk through this life all alone, all by yourself. He's designed it to be with Him. I'm not talking about having a spouse or all the rest of that. I'm talking about the fact that God wants to be walking with you. Regardless of your age, your status, or anything else, God wants to walk with you. And God basically says, yes, you're going to be facing circumstances and times that seem overwhelming and responsibilities and tasks that you don't know that you can actually complete. But with God's help, and if He's called you to it, you can, because of God's help. Now, can you change your circumstances? Well, maybe there are actually a few things you can change. And if so, do it, right? But do it with God's help, and do it with His wisdom and His leadership and His guiding. There may be things, let's say, like this whole news about coronavirus, or there might be past hurts from a parent or from a child or from somebody else. Now, some of those things you look and you say, well, I wasn't responsible for how they treated me, or I'm not responsible for this coronavirus, and so on and so forth. Right. If you can't change those things, yeah, they may not be your responsibility. But you can always change and alter your response. Most certainly you can do that, again, with God's help. For example, we talk about this coronavirus thing. Now, you can choose to live in fear, or you can choose to not live in fear. And I believe that's how we're supposed to be living with this. We are not supposed to be living in fear. Now, the other thing I think that is really clear, and this can be a real challenge now, not only now, but as this continues to unfold as to how we're going to get our economy and everything back up and running and so on, and life back to quote-unquote normal. You know what? I think one of the areas here that I really want to caution us against is make sure that we stop passing judgment on others who may not believe or practice things about this the same way you do. And we're seeing this more and more, aren't we? We're seeing people who think that, oh, you know what? We need to take all of these precautions, and they're becoming somewhat judgmental of others that are not. And yet we've got others that aren't taking a whole lot of precautions, or maybe none, and they're becoming very judgmental on the other side. And this is impacting our local area right here. Let's be very careful, because this is an opportunity that Satan can use to bring disunity, or this is an opportunity that God can use to bring unity, understanding, and love. Let's make sure that we're agents of the latter, that we are reaching out in love and respect as to how people are responding to this, and we can do so with love and care and compassion. I hope that the church would be a unifying factor through this time and not disunity. If you've dealt with past hurts from a parent or from a child or from somebody else, you can choose to live in regret and anger, or you can choose to forgive and to love them no matter what. You can choose to be encouraging and to work towards a better future. A great practice for us to ask ourselves when situations arise is, What can I do about this? If the situation is out of our control and we can't really do anything about it, then we need to come to grips with that and realize this isn't my responsibility. And then we need to allow God to do what only God can do. If that's out of our responsibility, but we're still concerned about it, let's pray to God. God, you know what? You know that situation. You're in control of that. I pray, God, your will to be done. Now, when we can do something about it, let's make sure that we walk in obedience to what God is calling us to do. Now, that may mean asking God for help, and I think that's where we should always start, is asking God for God's wisdom and guidance in our lives with everything that we face. And perhaps it may also be asking others for help as well. Now, that doesn't mean to replace God, by no means, but I truly believe that sometimes as we go through things, God has got people, put people in our lives, sometimes even books, materials, other resources, agencies that can help us through the problem that we're dealing with right in that moment. Let's be sure to ask God for help, and let's also be willing to ask others for help. But let's not jump there too quickly before we ask God, right? Let's always start with God first and also be asking others for help, because many times there are practical things that others are willing to help us through. So again, I don't want you to feel guilty about, oh, I'm supposed to be responsible for all these things and I'm feeling the weight of that. No, you know what? Let's share that as a body of believers. We need to allow ourselves sometimes to give up control, to say, maybe I can't handle this, even though this is my responsibility, I don't know how to handle it properly, and ask God for his guidance and his leadership. And then get up, pick up your mat, and walk. Now, I praise God that he has done all the work in regards to giving you the option of living a life that is forgiven and has a glorious hope and a future with him. He's done all the work, but he's left with you to say, here it is. Are you going to accept it? What are you going to do with that? That's your responsibility. Stop using excuses and be responsible to accept God's call and follow him. I praise God for mothers and for others that have exemplified that and continue to be examples of that in my life. So my challenge to you today is to be bold enough to say, get up, pick up your mat, and walk. Walk in obedience to Jesus Christ in all that we do. Amen.
Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust him. Precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that he is with me, will be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I've proved Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him.
For benediction today, I'd like to read to you from Ephesians chapter 3, verses 20 to 21. It reads as follows. Now to Him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to His power that is at work within us, to Him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.